Tanter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ballad of the Green Beret, The Life and Wars of Staff Sergeant Barry Sadler, from the Vietnam War and Pop Stardom to Murder and an Unsolved Violent Death, by Marc Leepson. Narrated by David DeVries. Prologue. A Soldier at Heart. Barry was one of the nicest guys you ever met in your life, and had one of the biggest hearts you'd ever seen, made the best friend you could possibly ask for, and the worst enemy that you didn't want. Earl Owens. When the telephone rings at 6:20 in the morning, the news rarely is good. The news wasn't very good at all when the bedside phone at Nashville literary agent Robbie Robison's suburban home bolted him awake before dawn on Saturday morning, December 2, 1978. His client and friend, Barry Sadler, the former Green Beret staff sergeant whose song The Ballad of the Green Berets was the number one hit single of the year 1966, was on the other end of the line. Sadler, age 38, was nursing a mug of coffee in a Shoney's restaurant in Hendersonville, a Nashville suburb. It had been a long, violent, memorable night. "Robbie, it went down last night," Sadler told his half-awake manager. "What went down?" "I shot him. I shot that dude. Would you come out here and let's talk?" Sometime between 10:30 and 10:50 the night before, on Friday, December 1, 1978, after an evening of drinking that started in a bar called the Natchez Trace Lounge, Barry Sadler shot and killed a washed-up country music singer-songwriter named Lee Emerson Bellamy. Barry gunned him down in the parking lot of the Knollwood Apartments in one of Nashville's quiet suburbs. Bellamy, a 56-year-old World War II veteran whose police record was almost as long as his recording credits, had made the mistake of trying to barge in on Barry Sadler and his female companion, Darlene Sharp, Bellamy's former girlfriend. For weeks, Bellamy had been harassing and threatening the 25-year-old waitress and would-be country music singer, as well as her famous former Green Beret friend. On this night, though, Lee Bellamy was not up to no good. He was looking for some recording equipment he'd left in the apartment. When Barry Sadler realized it was Bellamy ringing the apartment's doorbell, he bolted out the sliding patio doors, armed with a .38-caliber Smith & Wesson revolver and a nightstick given to him by the Chicago Police Department in 1966. When Bellamy saw the former Special Forces soldier, he hot-footed it back to his dilapidated white 1970 Ford cargo van, jumped in the driver's seat, and grabbed his keys. Sadler then ran up to the van. That's when Lee Bellamy made a literally fatal mistake. He dropped his car keys at his feet near the gas pedal. Then Bellamy looked up and turned to his left. The last thing he ever saw was Barry Sadler firing a shot with his .38 through the driver's side window. The bullet hit Lee Bellamy directly between the eyes. The shot propelled him backward, and he landed between the van's two front seats, the only ones in the vehicle. Barry then walked around to the other side of the van, pulled the sliding door open, climbed inside, and tossed the .38 on the floor at the bleeding Bellamy's feet. Then he commenced to beat Bellamy with a nightstick. Minutes after the shot rang out, eyewitnesses saw Darlene Sharp run out of the apartment into the parking lot, huddle with Barry on the passenger side of the van, and then walk back inside. She came back out a few minutes later and handed Barry another gun, a .32-caliber Mauser automatic pistol. He ejected a round from the Mauser's chamber and jacked a new one in, making it appear as if the gun had recently been fired. At 11:14 p.m., Darlene Sharp went back inside her one-bedroom apartment and called 911 to report a shooting. When K-9 officer Johnny Lucas arrived on the scene a few minutes later, he found Barry and Darlene in the parking lot. Lucas asked Barry to take a seat in the back of his cruiser. Barry told Lucas that he confronted Lee Bellamy after he had threatened Darlene and that he thought Bellamy was going for a gun. So he pulled out his .32 and shot to miss. If he had aimed to kill, Barry told the police officer, he would have done just that. Somehow, Barry said, Bellamy's gun, actually Barry's .38, went off in the car and a bullet from that weapon wound up between his eyes. "I saw him get into the passenger side of the van," Barry said. "I was coming up on him and I said stop. Then he came up with what looked like a piece. I got mine out and I again said stop. Then he began to turn. I'm an expert marksman, but I aimed in front of him so as to hit the glass. I shot one time, and the glass exploded, and he lurched backwards. I went over and climbed inside with him, and I saw blood, but I thought it was where the glass had hit him. Barry neglected to mention whaling Bellamy with the nightstick or throwing down the .38. Two more patrol cars arrived, as did Nashville homicide detective Jim Sledge, who was in the area working the midnight shift. A blunt-talking, solidly built, stocky former Marine, Sledge had been on the homicide squad for about 2 years. In that relatively short time, he'd investigated nearly 24 murders. He was about to get involved in the biggest murder case of his career. An ambulance came screaming into the parking lot and quickly sped Bellamy, who was still breathing, off to nearby St. Thomas Hospital. He was pronounced dead at 6:55 a.m. the next day, about a half hour after Barry Sadler had called Robbie Robison from Shoney's. The police took Barry and Darlene to St. Thomas, where they sat down with Jim Sledge in the hospital's quiet room. It was around midnight. Darlene was very upset, Sledge reported. She told him that she didn't know anything about the shooting. Barry was more forthcoming, giving Sledge his version of the events. At 2:30 a.m., Barry made a formal statement and signed it at the Criminal Investigations Division headquarters in downtown Nashville. After he fired his weapon, Barry said in the statement, I went over and climbed inside with him, and I saw blood, but I thought it was where the glass had hit him. I told Miss Sharp to call the police, which she did. He tried to assist Bellamy, Barry said, since his breathing was raspy. When Barry got in the van, he said, I saw a piece on the floor, which I left there until the police arrived. Jim Sledge did not arrest Barry Sadler or Darlene Sharp that night. He spent the next 6 months investigating the physical evidence and interviewing witnesses. The detective work paid off. Sledge took Barry into custody on June 1, 1979, at the bar in the Commodore Lounge at the Vanderbilt Holiday Inn. The charge? Second-degree murder. Sledge arrested Darlene the same day and charged her with accessory to murder. Barry Sadler hired the top criminal defense attorney in Nashville, Joe Binkley Sr., to defend him. There never was a trial. On May 8, 1980, Barry pleaded guilty to voluntary manslaughter and Darlene to being an accessory after the fact. The judge gave the former Green Beret 4 to 5 years and his companion a year in jail. On September 26, 1980, Barry Sadler's sentence was reduced to 2 years probation and 30 days in the county workhouse, and Darlene Sharp's to 1 year probation. Barry served 28 days at the minimum security workhouse and then walked out a free man. That sordid episode, Barry Sadler called it the worst experience of his life, came at the lowest point in the life of the formerly unknown 39-year-old former Green Beret staff sergeant. Barry was a high school dropout from a broken family who became a media sensation in February 1966 when his old-fashioned pro-military The Ballad of the Green Berets became the best-selling record in the country. The single would go on to sell some 9 million copies. The song's album sold more than 2 million. The records earned Barry fame and about $500,000 in royalties in 1966 alone. But the fame was fleeting. The Army took Barry off regular duties and sent him around the country as a human recruiting poster. Barry hated it. He got out of the U.S. Army as soon as the term of his enlistment ended in May of 1967 and moved to Tucson with his wife and two young sons. The plan? To make a living as a musician and an actor. But Barry never had another record even approaching a hit song. His acting career went nowhere. He opened a bar that leaked money. He tried running a battery store. That venture fizzled. The family moved to Nashville in 1973, where Barry tried to jumpstart his musical career. He couldn't. By 1978, with the royalty money long gone, Barry carried on open love affairs and drank to excess. Barry Sadler's second act, as the author of a slew of pulp fiction novels, began soon after the Lee Bellamy episode. But the drinking and womanizing continued. Before long, Sadler's wife, Lavona, decided they could no longer live together, and he moved out of their modest suburban home. In January 1984, Berry went into a kind of exile, moving to Guatemala and settling into a small ranch outside Guatemala City. Rumors flew that he was running a mercenary operation, training anti-communist Nicaraguan guerrilla fighters, the Contras, and conducting international arms deals. But he was mainly churning out books and drinking and carousing in his four-bedroom country villa and in the bars of Guatemala City. On September 7, 1988, Barry Sadler took a bullet to the head in a taxicab in Guatemala City after a day and night of drinking. Details of the shooting are murky. The authorities said he shot himself in a drunken accident. Others claimed it was a robbery or an attempted assassination by communist guerrillas or personal enemies. He was brought back to the United States and spent the next 16 months as a brain-damaged quadriplegic in three VA hospitals. Barry Sadler died on November 5, 1989, 4 days after his 49th birthday. The startling but short-lived success Barry Sadler had in 1966 turned out to be a very sharp, double-edged sword. After overcoming a difficult childhood, serving honorably for 4 years in the U.S. Air Force and 5 more in the Army, and after surviving a 5-month tour of duty in the Vietnam War, Barry Sadler was on the road to an honorable, if under-the-radar, military career. But the Ballad of the Green Berets uprooted him from the military life that he had envisioned. Soon, he was broke, unhappy, and stumbling along life's path. He ran with a rough crowd. He also read voraciously and wrote 29 pulp fiction books. His dry wit charmed many a man and many women. Nobody could tell a joke like Barry did, often in dialect, a friend from the 1980s, Jay Diamond, said. He was the best storyteller I ever knew, and one of the funniest. Barry's marriage, though, was dysfunctional at best. He killed Lee Bellamy and all but got away with it. He fled the country to live a wild life in Central America. He wound up with a bullet in his head in the middle of the night and died after more than a year, confined to hospital beds, barely able to speak, and unable to walk or feed himself. The man who in 1966 was the Audie Murphy of the Vietnam War, a handsome, famous, charismatic war hero made into a showbiz celebrity, had been undone because he couldn't handle the fame that his creation unleashed. The Ballad of the Green Berets is very much alive today, more than 50 years after its sensational birth. It became the song of the century as far as Special Forces is concerned, said Steve Bruno, who went through Green Beret medic training with Barry. The Ballad, the theme song for the U.S. Army Special Forces, is played for Special Forces trainees at Fort Bragg and is heard at every Special Forces reunion and at more than one Green Beret's funeral. The Ballad also was the only notable and popular pro-military song to come out of the entire Vietnam War, and Barry became arguably the most famous American who served in that controversial war. And yet, the Ballad of the Green Berets all but destroyed the man who created it. In many ways, the success of that song was the worst thing that ever happened to him, said Jim Morris, a writer and a former Green Beret who edited Barry's last 2 books. Without that, I have the feeling that he would have stayed in the Army. He would have been happier. Barry looked at that song as a curse in a lot of ways, Barry's one-time Nashville drinking buddy Bill Parrish said. He said all he ever wanted to do was be a soldier. He's a born soldier, a dedicated soldier, Barry's mother Bibi said in 1988. He told me, that's what I'm good at. Let me be one. I'm a soldier at heart. The song kept him forever from doing what he liked doing. Soldiering, Lavona Sadler said. He wasn't a happy man. Barry never had a carefree life, his Nashville friend Gary Sizemore said. Like people with a remarkable mind who aren't using it in a way that pleases them, he was never happy. He would have been happier if he'd never written that song. I wish, Barry told his friend Robert M. Powers in 1971, that I'd never, ever written that stupid song. Chapter 1. Tough Guy. Sometimes they had nothing to eat except ketchup and bread. Lavona Sadler. Barry Allen Sadler was born on November 1, 1940, in the southeastern New Mexico town of Carlsbad. In his 1967 autobiography, I'm a Lucky One, Berry briefly speculated about his ancestry, saying that he had an idea that the Sadlers were of German descent with a touch of Black Irish. A genealogical chart indicates that Berry's oldest Sadler relative, William Sharp Sadler, was born in 1778 in South Carolina. The chart also shows his mother's and father's forebearers were born in France, Canada, and England, but not Germany. The most common of his ancestor surnames are French and English in origin: Bonin, Borel, de Rouen, Hayes, Littlefield, Stanley, and Taliaferro. One of the Littlefields, Berry's maternal grandmother, Ethel Bell Littlefield, came to an untimely end. On April 14, 1928, at age 30, she was shot to death by a man named S.J. King at a filling station she operated in the tiny North Texas town of Memphis. King then committed suicide with the same pistol he used to shoot Ethel Littlefield to death. In his book, Sadler painted an idyllic picture of his earliest days growing up in the high desert oasis town on the Pecos River, best known for the nearby Carlsbad Caverns. He wrote that he and his family, his father, John Bright Sadler, who was 29 when Berry came along, mother, Blanche Hansford Beebe Littlefield Sadler, age 22, and four-year-old brother Bob, enjoyed the good life on a 21-acre farm called Happy Valley just outside town. His father, who had studied at Arizona State University, Berry wrote, was from Phoenix, as was his mother, whom he believed took the name Beebe because she admired the popular and Texas-born Hollywood silent film actress Beebe Daniels. John Sadler developed a successful plumbing and electrical business in Carlsbad, his son wrote. With that success, Sadler Sr. bought several farms in and around the city, where the Sadler boys spent their earliest years. My brother and I did some of the farm work, Berry said. Dad worked hard himself and believed that everybody else should work. Dad also was a former boxer and a very strong man. His sons would inherit that physical strength in spades. Bob Sadler spent many years working as a miner in New Mexico and Colorado. His younger brother, at around 5'8" and 200 pounds, was, pound for pound, one of the strongest men I've ever known, Bill Parrish said. When he first met Berry in the late 70s, Parrish said he could get in the squat position and pick up a 200-pound man by the ankles and stand up with him with his arms extended straight. In 1945, when Berry was 5 years old, his parents divorced. On January 11, 1948, John B. Sadler died of cancer at his home in Carlsbad at age 36. The Sadler boys, aged 7 and 12, fell into what Berry called a wandering life with our mother. They banged around the Southwest, stopping in a slew of places in New Mexico, Arizona, California, and Colorado. They moved around a lot, John Buchan, another friend from Sadler's days in Nashville, said. Berry said it was a pretty chaotic life. Beebe Sadler, Berry wrote, had few skills but plenty of courage and determination. She managed restaurants and bars, he said, some of them in gambling casinos. His mother managing restaurants and bars, sometimes in the occasional gambling establishment, and his father running a big plumbing and electrical business was the story Berry chose to tell for the record. But he gave different versions to friends and newspaper reporters. He told a Time magazine reporter in 1966, for example, that his father was an itinerant plumber and his mother a barmaid. And, in fact, the 1940 U.S. Census lists John Sadler's occupation as plumber's helper and his place of employment as a plumber shop. The census also has the family living not on a ranch, but in the Silver Dollar Apartments on West Bronson Street in the city of Carlsbad. Then there is the matter of his mother's occupation. At different times later in life, Berry Sadler told friends that his mother was an itinerant gambler, a poker shill, and a sometimes prostitute. In April of 1966, for example, when a young woman asked him how he learned to play the guitar, he replied, "In a whorehouse in New Mexico where my mother was working." Berry told me on one occasion, and I don't know whether it was under the influence or it just came out, that his mother was a prostitute. Jimmy Walker, who served with Berry in Vietnam, said, "It seems to me that he said he sort of had multiple mothers who were sisters in prostitution, and they took good care of him. Bebe Sadler was a prostitute, a woman who knew Barry and his family as a teenager in Leadville, Colorado, said. You would see her at 2 a.m. in Clyde's Cafe after the bars closed. She and other prostitutes would be in there with men. The guys would have a cup of coffee and buy steaks for the women. That was the 50s in Leadville. Barry told his old Nashville friend Bill Parrish that his mother was a shill in poker games and a prostitute growing up around mining areas in New Mexico and Leadville, Colorado, Parrish said in 2015. He said he never really had a mother. It's all but certain, then, that Bebe Sadler plied the world's oldest profession. She probably was, her daughter-in-law Lavona said, but I don't know. I do know she was a gambler and hung in the bars, and she was married quite a few times. Bebe, Barry, and Bob settled in the 2-mile-high Colorado Front Range mineral belt city of Leadville in the heart of the Rocky Mountains when Barry was about 10 years old. The one-time booming gold mining and then silver mining town of the 1870s hardly resembled its former self in the early 1950s. Its population had dwindled from more than 40,000 at its peak to some 5,000 hearty souls. It was a gritty, mostly blue-collar lead mining town that happened to be the highest incorporated city in the country. Perched at just over 10,000 feet amid the Rocky Mountains' highest peaks on the Continental Divide, Leadville is surrounded by high alpine forests and glacial lakes and the ski resorts of Vail, Copper Mountain, Breckenridge, and Aspen. Snowfall averages more than 10 feet a year. Leadville still had the rough edge that had earned it a reputation as the wickedest town in the West when the Sadlers lived there, Jillian Klukas wrote in her History of Leadville. Transient miners could choose from a number of raucous bars. It was said that distributors sold more alcohol to Leadville's liquor stores and bars than to any other Colorado small town. When I grew up in Leadville in the 1950s, it was a rowdy town, Thomas Gomez, a younger brother of Barry's best friend Delfino, Del Gomez, said. Harrison Avenue had bars on every corner. When we'd go out for Halloween, my parents would always tell us to stay away from the bars. It appears that Bebe and her two boys lived in an apartment in the building that housed one of Leadville's oldest and most famous drinking establishments, the Pioneer Club Bar and Cafe on West 2nd Street, which had been built in 1882. The Pioneer, which was nothing much to look at on the outside, but retained its 2 ornate bars, complete with bullet holes, glassware cabinets, and other trappings inside, featured a dance floor on the ground level. The Pioneer also housed a brothel on the 2nd floor, with private rooms that men patronized using a separate entrance. The colorful Hazel Gillette Ma Brown ran the place until her death in 1970. Everybody in town knew of Ma Brown, said Howard Tritz, who was born in 1936 in Leadville and grew up there. The Pioneer was a brothel for years. By the 60s, it had dwindled down to 1 or 2 working ladies. Ma Brown, who sported cat's-eye glasses studded with diamonds, had a reputation as a madam with a soft spot for wayward boys. She still had a brothel in the 1960s and had girls at the bar, according to Janice Fox, the local history coordinator at the Lake County Library in Leadville. And Barry's brother was the manager of the bar in the mid-1960s. Ma Brown must have taken Barry under her wing as well. She was wonderful to the boys she raised. There were no luxuries growing up in Leadville, Barry said in his book, but we didn't miss any meals. That was the I'm a lucky one version of life with Bebe as a single mother. But again, Barry told a different story about his childhood to friends and family. He told me they didn't have anything, Lavona said. I thought he was making it up. There were times, she said, when Barry told her that they had nothing to eat except ketchup and bread. Barry wrote that he loved the outdoors, especially hunting. My brother says the first gun I fired was a shotgun, he said. When I was 9 or 10, I was shooting rabbits and trying for bobcats in the cliffs around Leadville. I shot grouse on the wing with a .22 caliber pistol. In fact, I was a better shot with a pistol at 50 yards than most men are with a rifle. Weapons would play an integral part in his life until the day Barry Sadler died in November 1989 after taking a gunshot wound to the head in September 1988. Music, too, was always part of Barry's life. His earliest memories included listening to cowboy, western, and Mexican music on the radio. As a boy, he played the flute, harmonica, drums, and guitar, although he never took a lesson and could not read music. He told a reporter that he learned to play the drums in honky-tonks where his mother worked. "I wasn't no Gene Krupa, but I could get by," Berry said of his drumming ability. Berry's favorite tunes growing up included Cielito Lindo, Ay 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 Ay, La Cucaracha, Deep in the Heart of Texas, Home on the Range, and Oh Bury Me Not on the Lone Prairie. When life with BB was too much, as it often was, Berry sought refuge in several ways. One was reading. "Berry told me he started reading at age 3 as an escape," Bill Parrish said, "and that he became a lifelong voracious reader." Berry also sought refuge with Ma Brown. In fact, Berry listed Hazel Brown of 118 West 2nd Street in Leadville as one of his credit references on a military security form he filled out in 1963. Berry also spent a good deal of time in the welcoming home of Del Gomez, who became his best friend. Berry spent many hours and days in the Gomez house with Delfino's father, Epi, his mother, Sedelia, and their 10 children, 5 boys and 5 girls. He called Sedelia Gomez Mama and loved her cooking, including his favorite meal, chili and beans. "They were extremely close. They were like brothers," said Delfino's daughter, Loretta Sparkman. Berry would spend the night at my grandma's. She said it was because his mom wasn't really all that great of a mom. Sometimes it would be for a couple of days. Sometimes it would be for overnight, or he'd come after school and hang out. Berry and Delfino would go downtown and hang out with all the girls and go out on double dates. Berry, whom the Gomez family called Bear, spent a lot of time at my home, Tommy Gomez said. He didn't have what I would call a real home. He was at my home at least 4 to 5 days a week. He would eat with us. He spent many holidays with us, Christmas, Thanksgiving, and Easter. He was very, very close to my mom and dad. They became more or less surrogate parents to Bear. He would share everything with them. He and Delfino were both from the wrong side of the tracks, Berry wrote in his book, had been in all sorts of scrapes together and liked each other a lot. Berry, who had a lifelong affinity for foreign languages, learned to speak Spanish during the countless hours he spent in the Gomez home. "He learned that from Delfino," Lavona Sadler said of her husband's proficiency in Spanish. Berry was always over at his house, where he learned to speak fluent Spanish. Berry and Del often hung out with a handful of other Leadville teenagers. Bear was always wearing Levi's, and he'd always have a leather jacket and engineer boots, and he wore his hair in a pompadour, Tommy Gomez said. At that time, he had almost white blonde hair. Bear was a tough guy, and nobody messed with him. Berry, Del, and the boys got into their share of mischief and trouble with the law. But were they juvenile delinquents? Howard Tritz, for one, didn't think so. "They looked like ordinary kids," he said of Berry and Delfino. "Maybe all the kids looked like that in Leadville. They didn't look that bad. I'd call them rascals." Still, there were joyrides, hubcap stealing, lots of other mischief, and petty theft. Blowing up the occasional phone booth with a string of M60 firecrackers, drinking, smoking cigarettes, getting into fights in Leadville and in the nearby town of Buena Vista. "Bear was always the tough guy," a high school friend said. "Nobody messed with Bear, and nobody messed with Bear's friends. If you were one of Bear's friends, nobody messed with you." Tommy Gomez said he never saw Barry hit anyone, but he said if they came looking for it, I'm sure he'd take care of it. On occasion, someone did mess with Barry, who, he admitted in his autobiography, was quick to anger and quicker with his fists. "Somebody would say something that I thought reflected on my family, and before I knew it, I'd be hitting him," Barry wrote. "I couldn't pick unimportant people. I'd always have to tangle with the son of the head of the Chamber of Commerce, or the brother of the mayor, people like that. And I was soon very unpopular with the big people in town and known as a rotten kid." Berry started at Leadville Senior High School as a 10th grader in the fall of 1955. He completed 10th and 11th grade there, but did not exactly excel academically. His report cards were dotted with C's, D's, and F's. Berry did not return to Leadville High for his senior year, which started in September of 1957. Sometime that summer, he left town and started hitchhiking across the country, he wrote. But life on the road offered nothing but misery for the troublemaking, uneducated teenager. So, in the spring of 1958, Berry went back to Leadville and decided to join the U.S. Air Force. He raised his hand and promised to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, on June 2, 1958. On his enlistment form, Sadler wrote his home address as 118 West 2nd Street in Leadville, the same address as the pioneer. The Gomez family believes that Epi Gomez played an important role in Berry's decision to get out of Leadville and into the military. "My dad was a very well-spoken man. He was well-respected in Leadville," Tommy Gomez said. Bear knew this, and he always wanted to emulate something that was good, not the negativity he grew up with. "He would spend a lot of time talking with my dad. Bear would ask him for advice. One of the things my dad always told him was, you need to get beyond the way you grew up, the things you were exposed to, and you need to be a good person. He told Bear numerous times, you have the potential to become something if you just put it to use. I remember Bear having respect enough for my dad that whenever he would tell him something, Bear would listen. And I truly believe that's part of the reason Bear turned his life around and decided to do what he did after he went into the military. Epi Gomez," his son Tommy said, "had a major, major influence on Berry's life. In his book, Berry wrote that he joined the military because he felt the Air Force could do things for me. But again, he told friends a different story. He said he was a big boy for his age. At 15, he was bouncing in a bar," Bill Parrish said. "Some guy was in there having trouble, and Berry kind of sucker punched him. He said the guy bounced right back up, and Berry said it was time for him to get out of Leadville and go in the Air Force. At 17, Sadler was a bar bouncer in Leadville, Colorado," R. Kent Burton wrote in a profile of Berry in the Tucson Daily Citizen in 1972. "He was knifed 7 times and shot once before he turned 18. That most likely is an exaggeration. But it's all but certain that Berry realized he needed to change his life drastically in 1958. He told a Chicago Sun-Times reporter that he was getting into a lot of trouble, trouble and fights and going nowhere, so I figured if I didn't join up, well, I'd wind up a bum. Berry told another interviewer the same thing. I knew I'd wind up in jail the way I was going," he said. "All I knew how to do was fight, so I enlisted in the Air Force and they took me." Another important factor motivated the 17-year-old to join the military, something Berry Sadler didn't mention in his autobiography or speak of to many friends. "Why the hell did you quit school and go in the service?" Sadler's literary agent and friend Rob Robison asked him one day. "Damn it, Robbie," Sadler replied. "I was hungry." That, Robison said, tells you a lot. Chapter 2. An Extreme Beginner. I showed Berry some chords, and we would sit around the barracks plunking our guitars. Paul Alford. Berry Sadler served in the U.S. Air Force for 4 years. The one-time rotten kid received his honorable discharge on September 26, 1962, having indeed served his country honorably, beginning with basic training at Lackland Air Force Base in San Antonio, Texas. His service included a year in Japan and 3 stateside assignments. As it has been for untold numbers of American young people, serving in the military served as Berry Sadler's rite of passage into young adulthood. He stayed out of official trouble, working conscientiously as a radar technician, picked up his high school diploma, learned Japanese, and became a martial arts expert. Sadler's service began at Lackland, then, as now, the Air Force's only basic training center for enlisted personnel, where he found plenty to eat and plenty of ways to excel. I did feel a little proud when I saw Sadler in block letters on my blouse for the first time, Berry wrote in his autobiography. I had no problems. I liked the Air Force. Thanks to my mountain-developed marksmanship, I had the highest score on our first day at the rifle range. Berry wanted to be an armament maintenance specialist primarily because of his interest in and success with guns. But after he took the military aptitude test, the military decided Airman Sadler would best suit the service's needs by becoming a radar technician. So Berry and about 20 other recruits piled into a bus in July of 1958 and went off to Keesler Air Force Base in the Gulf Coast city of Biloxi, Mississippi, for radar training. He may have had an aptitude for it, but when Berry arrived at Keesler, he had never so much as even seen a piece of radar equipment. That did not deter the teenaged recruit. He sailed through radar school. After a 20-day leave back in Leadville, Berry shipped out to his first permanent duty station, a radar installation in Japan. Late in September of 1958, Berry climbed aboard a chartered Flying Tiger Line C-121 transport plane and flew across the Pacific. After stopping in Hawaii and Wake Island to refuel, the four-prop C-121 landed at the U.S. military air base at Tachikawa, just outside Tokyo. The Air Force assigned Berry to an aircraft control and warning service air defense radar station on Mount Minokayama, on a peninsula across Tokyo Bay from Yokohama. Airman Sadler spent the next 13 months in Japan. It proved to be a rewarding experience. "I liked Japan from the start," Berry said. "The people were friendly, the duty, tracking planes coming into Japanese airspace, was not difficult, and there was plenty of leisure time." In his off-duty hours, Berry read voraciously. He also went eel fishing, swimming, and skin diving in Tokyo Bay. And he played tourist in small towns and large cities near the base. But he didn't exactly keep in touch with his family back home. "Berry wasn't much of a letter writer," said fellow airman Harold H.D. Graham, who met Sadler at Travis Air Force Base in California in 1962. "I think he told me that all the time he was in Japan, he maybe wrote his family 5 or 6 times. Berry and H.D. Graham corresponded for about 20 years, but for every 2 letters I wrote to him, he probably wrote back 1. On November 1, 1958, his 18th birthday, Berry visited Tokyo for the first time. He went to the usual tourist attractions, sampled Tokyo shops, and then spent most of the night in a bar. Berry and a buddy bought the bar, he said, chased everybody out except some girls, and spent the night sampling everything. On a subsequent trip to Tokyo, Berry underwent another young serviceman's rite of passage. He had a small blue panther tattooed on his right arm, just below the shoulder. Berry had arrived in Japan as an airman, the second lowest enlisted rank in the Air Force. Within a few weeks, he received a promotion to Airman Second Class, the equivalent of the Army's Private First Class. He studied for and passed the GED test, receiving his high school diploma. He acquired a Japanese girlfriend, Yoko, a 5-foot-2-inch living doll, as he put it, who worked at a bar near the radar base. He apprenticed himself to a judo and karate teacher, Aikawa Kaiichi, a carpenter at the radar station, who was in his 70s. "He took me into his home and made me a member of his seaside village," Sadler wrote. "Thanks to Kaiichi's interest and friendship, I saw more of Japanese family life than do most Americans who go to Japan." Berry really enjoyed Japan and the Japanese families he met, H.D. Graham said. They treated him very well, more or less took him as their own son. Before long, Berry had mastered rudimentary Japanese, his third language. Berry said he took judo lessons for 4 hours a day, 4 or 5 days a week, at his mentor's home and at the judo hut on the radar base. The intense training paid off. Berry gained about 35 pounds of mostly muscle, putting close to 200 pounds on his 5-foot-9-inch frame. He claimed he developed a 17-inch neck and 17-inch biceps, and he sparred against the toughest professionals in the neighborhood. Berry thrived in judo tournaments, including, by his account, winning 9 straight fights in 1 afternoon, a feat that earned him a black belt. "Berry told me he almost went Oriental because of all the training," Bill Parrish said. "It was the whole samurai aspect of it, the mental aspect. In fighting, if you're injured, as an example, the samurai developed the mental ability to put a tourniquet on an extremity to stop the bleeding. I've seen Sadler demonstrate many times being able to stop the blood flow to an arm and have you check for a pulse, and he said he could do it with his arms or legs. I'd try both arms, and there was no pulse rate." Although Berry never practiced as intently as he had in Japan, he continued to keep his hand in with karate, judo, and other martial arts for decades. Berry knew many styles of martial arts, Shotokan, Ishinru, and a little bit of everything else, Parrish said. In the 1980s, his right hand looked like a shillelagh from his breaking techniques, breaking boards, breaking block, brick. The 2 knuckles of the index finger and middle finger were more like weapon, I'll put it that way. Berry's tour of duty in Japan ended in October of 1959. His next assignment, the General Surveillance Radar Station at Madera Air Force Station in Central California. He plied his radar trade, still on the lookout for attacking aircraft from the Soviet Union, with the 774th Aircraft Control and Warning Squadron at Madera until July of 1960, when he received orders to go to Richards Gebauer Air Force Base near Kansas City, Missouri. He learned the ins and outs of the newly developed automated SAGE radar system for 3 months there. Berry ended his Air Force career at Beale Air Force Base in the small central California town of Marysville, about 125 miles northeast of San Francisco. He did not have a guitar during his Air Force days until he got to Beale. I sold him a guitar, a Harmony Monterey, that I bought in Kansas City for $25, I think it was, Paul Alford, one of Berry's best Air Force buddies, said in 2016. I showed Berry some chords, and we would sit around the barracks plunking our guitars. What kind of a musician was the 20-year-old Barry Sadler? He was an extreme beginner on the guitar, Alford said. He knew the basics. He could make a C chord and a G chord. As a singer, he was certainly no Vic Damone or Frank Sinatra. He could sing really simple stuff. He was kind of an average guy who could carry a tune. Barry received his second promotion at Beale, to Airman First Class. He also gave the occasional judo lesson at March Air Force Base in Southern California and at the Sheriff's Department in Marysville. Berry also took part in the activities that most young servicemen indulged in at the time, drinking and partying hard in the barracks and in off-base bars, along with the occasional wild road trip. It was just normal stuff, nothing out of the ordinary, Paul Alford said. We'd drink beer or tequila in the barracks during off-duty hours. Once in a while, we'd go down to a bar, usually Eddie's Lounge in Marysville. Barry's favorite drink was straight tequila, with a little lime and salt. After one solo trip to Marysville, Barry wound up spending a night in jail, although he was not charged with any crime. After getting a ride to town, he hitchhiked back to the base. The police stopped the car that picked me up, he later said, and took everybody in. They released me with no charges. The road trips included jaunts to Sacramento, San Francisco, and even Los Angeles, about 500 miles away. One time, Barry, Alford, and two buddies crammed into a tiny Triumph sports car and sped off to San Francisco. After driving around Frisco all day, we parked at a remote beach area to try and get a few hours shut-eye, Alford said. The other guys slept in the front seats, and I tried to sleep in the jump seat. Barry had found an old blanket in the back of the car and rolled himself up in it on the beach sand. He probably got a better night's sleep than any of us. One weekend, the group took off for L.A. on the spur of the moment. Let's go, we said, and we did, just like that, Alford said, with only the clothes we had on and less than $10 apiece. We stayed at a buddy's parents' house and just about drove them crazy at night and hit the beach all day. Some of his fellow airmen thought Barry was kind of strange, Alford said. One of his eccentricities was Barry's ability to hypnotize people. He would entertain us in the barracks some evenings, hypnotizing guys who volunteered, Alford said. He said he learned it from a psychiatrist in reform school in Leadville. Barry occasionally, Alford said, slipped into somber moods at Beale. You didn't want to mess with him when he was in that mood, he said. I never saw him get into a confrontation where he needed to use his martial arts skills, but he was not a guy I'd mess with if I was going to mess with somebody. And then there was Barry's penchant for talking about how much he admired Nazi Germany. If you didn't know him, you would have gotten the impression that he was an extreme kind of Nazi and anti-Jew, Alford said. He was fascinated with military regimentation and command strategy and admired the German soldier mystique and Hitler's use of discipline. Because he expressed this, I think he felt a need to seem anti-Jewish. Barry would joke with the two Jewish guys in his squadron, Alford said. He liked them and kidded with them and made jokes that were extremely distasteful and repulsive under normal circumstances, like saying, "I'm going to turn you into a lampshade." But he made them in a joking, teasing manner. If they had asked him for $5, he'd lend it to them. It's not like he was out to get them or anything like that. Barry found little to like at Beale Air Force Base. For one thing, the base wasn't exactly a garden spot. It was a rambling, dusty place in the early stages of being reclaimed from long disuse, Alford said. For another, Barry was growing tired of staring at radar screens day and night. Barry never seemed particularly happy there, Alford said. We were in radar. It was essential, but rather boring. The Air Force was easy and not particularly military in the same sense the Army was. The character of the Air Force didn't seem to fit Barry's character. H.D. Graham agreed. Barry was an outdoors person, rough and ready, he said. It seemed to me like he was not displeased with the Air Force, but was not really happy because it wasn't exactly like he thought it would be. Learning where his next assignment would be convinced Barry to end his commitment to the Air Force when his 4-year enlistment ended. He was told he was going to be shipped to the Aleutians, Graham said. He didn't want that. He didn't like cold weather. So Barry took his honorable discharge on June 1, 1962. He hung around the farming community of Marysville for a short time and then went home to Leadville. When he couldn't find a job, Barry said that he and a buddy named Walter Lane tossed my guitar and his drums into a 1953 Chevrolet, and we hit the road in an effort to make a living playing in bars, honky-tonks, shopping centers, and any place else that would have us. It was the first time, Barry said, that he sang in public. He liked it, and contemplated for the first time what it might be like to make a life and living as a singer. I was sitting out on the patio of a Nuevo Laredo whorehouse, and all the girls came out to listen to me sing instead of staying inside to hustle, Barry said in 1966. I decided I might someday have a future as a singer. With a Negro piano player named Elmo from Marysville, the trio wandered through Colorado, Wyoming, Montana, Washington, Oregon, California, and Texas in that 1953 Chevy, looking for gigs. When they couldn't find them, the budding musicians took temporary jobs working in orchards, including DiGiorgio's Fruit Company in Marysville. They also loaded crates of fruit onto railroad cars for $1.10 an hour. It was backbreaking, and by August, I was tired of it, Barry said. I was getting nowhere. He also realized, he said, that he was becoming a hood. So on August 8, 1962, a little more than 2 months after he left the Air Force, Barry drove to Oakland, California, and walked into a military recruiting office. He intended, Barry would later tell people, to rejoin the Air Force. But the Air Force recruiter was away from his desk, so Barry went next door to the Army recruiter's office and enlisted for 3 years. He listed his permanent mailing address again as 118 West 2nd Street in Leadville, the Pioneer Bar. His height at 5 feet 8 inches and his weight at 175 pounds. As for family, Barry wrote that both his mother B.B. and his brother Robert's addresses were unknown. Have not seen or heard from any of my relatives since 1961, he wrote on the form. Because of his former service, the Army let Barry Sadler begin serving as a private first class, 2 pay grades up from private E1, the standard rank for new enlistees. Barry spent the next 2 months at Fort Ord in California. I arrived there with just $3 in my pocket, the clothes on my back, he said, and a little carry bag in which I had 1 pair of Levi's and a shirt. Chapter 3. Why don't you write a song about us? 100 men will test today, but only 3 win the Green Beret. The Ballad of the Green Berets. When Barry Sadler joined the U.S. Army, he chose the most rigorous and difficult military occupational specialty, Special Forces, SF. The military had informal units that took on unconventional, dangerous, and sometimes covert missions going back to the French and Indian War. The nation's first organized special forces, the famed Office of Strategic Services, OSS, the predecessor of the CIA, and the Army's first special service force, nicknamed the Devil's Brigade, were not formed until World War II. On June 20, 1952, the Army formally started its first SF unit, the 10th Special Forces Group at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. The following year, some special forces outfits began wearing green berets. Within a few years, all Special Forces troops sported the distinctive headgear. Even though the men wore them, though, the beret was not an official part of the uniform. That didn't happen until 1961. The catalysts were President John F. Kennedy and U.S. Army Major General William the Big Y Yarborough, the commander of the Army Special Warfare Center at Fort Bragg. The young, dynamic president and the battle-hardened general both strongly believed in the unconventional counterinsurgency SF concept, and both knew very well the value of symbols to sell the public on what was then a largely untested and potentially controversial idea. On October 12, 1961, 9 months after taking office, Kennedy paid a highly publicized visit to the Special Warfare Center at Fort Bragg. General Yarborough, a West Point graduate and World War II paratrooper who had fought in North Africa, Sicily, and Italy, greeted JFK wearing a Green Beret. What came next is part of Special Forces lore. "Those are nice," JFK told Yarborough. "How do you like the Green Beret?" To which the general replied, "They're fine, sir. We've wanted them a long time." A few days later, the commander-in-chief sent Yarborough a message. "The challenge of this old but new form of operations is a real one, and I know that you and the members of your command will carry on for us and the free world in a manner which is both worthy and inspiring," JFK wrote. "I am sure that the Green Beret will be a mark of distinction in the trying times."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.